is Mary McCarthy. I've met some of you before. I want to begin by expressing my appreciation for your service to the library. I know we all share the fact that we're lovers of libraries. I'm sorry I can't stay for the whole meeting. My husband pushed me out the door. My whole family is very committed to the library. My husband had eye surgery today, so I just put it in a statement and then go back home. He's doing fine, but I don't believe it. And speaking of my family, we live close to the library. We use the library. We use the YMCA. My grandson works at the YMCA. He's a lifeguard there. My husband and I have been volunteer tutors for children in North Albany for over a decade. This library is a critical service for them. And I'm speaking tonight with the support of Councilman Kelly Kimbrough and the principal of the North Albany Academy, Leslie Buff. Some main points I'd like to make, and I did put these on a handout for you. You yourselves acknowledge on your website that this is one of 7 award-winning libraries. And you have some very fine things to say about it. Some of the concerns I've heard that I'd like to address is utilization has been raised as an issue. But looking at the numbers that were available from the library's sources online, the North Albany Library has 2% of the square footage, but 6% of the usage. I would call that a success. And even if you take away non-resident usage, which I don't think you should, because that's part of the benefit of the Interlibrary Association. But even discounting that, they have 2% of the area and 4% of the usage. I've heard a concern about the hours. I don't see that the hours are significantly different than the other branches. So I would just raise that as a question mark. More money. I'll share that I've been a CEO myself. I've also been a fiscal analyst for the state of New York. Looking at your budget, in a $7 million operating budget, a $9 million total budget, the rent, which has been raised as a concern, is 0.2% of your budget. Not even a full percentage point, 2.2%. It would go up to 0.4% if the full amount, I understand, that might be asked by the Y was needed. With all due respect, I think any good management team could shuffle their funds and cover such a small percentage, especially when this is such an underserved area and the students there need a library. There's been talk about maybe doing something different in the future. Please, there can't be a gap in service. If there's a gap in service, the habits of going to the library, of using the computers, all of this would be interrupted and lost. I really urge you to take the idea of not renewing the lease off the table. What I'll do is I'll hand out this, which has more complete information. And I also have a sheet that has highlights of student comments about how they feel about the North Albany Library. Sorry, actually, speaking in public is my least favorite thing.
You're doing great.
Questions, and Kelly's name is there too. Oh, and I forgot to mention that Leslie Buff would be here, but it is the North Albany Academy's winter concert tonight. Thank you very much. I appreciate you.
Thank you.
Is there any other public comments? Great. It's time to review the minutes.
I'll make a motion.
Second.
Sarah, in favor?
Aye.
Carrie? The treasurer's report, check register.
Check register on your desk.
So this is for half of the month?
This is through today.
Through today, so we're gonna have that emergency.
Right.
I have one question. The two checks to La Court.
Yep.
One is the construction grant, that's for our,
Panel boards.
Panel boards. And then the other says.
The other one.
Is maintenance?
Yes, and that's lighting for the front of Washington. Lighting.
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 Okay, so it's just that that's coming out of our operations.
That's correct, yep.
So the motion to accept the check register.
Any questions?
Second.
Oh.
All in favor?
Aye.
Remember that you can maybe schedule for 21st.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
The next meeting is 21st.
Yes.
So we schedule the special meeting for the 21st.
And that'll be at the Washington Avenue branch, I think, in the Tompkins lot.
Okay.
Or the Baker space. Since it's a Thursday night, we need to maintain that it's public, but we're doing it at Washington Avenue because that's the space we can reserve. So it might actually be in the Baker space, so we're close to it.
Okay, just want to remind everybody that we did it again, so we can approve more checks.
If you indicated you could come, please make sure to come because you are the core.
And I'm the captain.
Okay, so treasurer's report, anything we want to highlight or have questions about in that? When does the branch improvement plan stuff hit?
The bond?
Yeah.
That Chuck didn't note it, but that's unpaid.
Okay.
Yep.
It's a little different this year than it was last year, now it goes into a trust.
It's automatic, he really should have reflected that. It actually was paid in late September, early October.
So any more questions, can I have a motion to accept the treasurer's report?
Make a motion.
Thank you. Second. Sarah, thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Presentation by Albany Promise.
So, as many of you know, we have a relationship with the Albany Promise, including some of our staff and some of their committees, and I'm on the.
Leadership Council.
Leadership Council. Albany Promise is something that was, I was a bit of a hard sell on, and may have made a little bit more of a ruckus than I should have. However, I am starting to understand what they do for the city, and this study, I think, or how they're helping us right now really kind of bears fruit to that, which is analyzing the success of our summer reading program. So Juliet's gonna kind of explain how the whole process worked and also some of the initial findings that we have.
Yeah, absolutely. So good evening, I'm Juliet Price, I'm the director of the Albany Promise. I think as Scott has said, you all may have had various interactions, experiences with Albany Promise along the way. And this is really an opportunity for us to talk with you guys about some of the work that we've led directly with Albany Public Library. So I always have to say, kind of like starting out, we so appreciate Scott's leadership on this. So I'll tell you a little bit quickly about what the Albany Promise is, but I think one of the things that so needs to be restated is we're not a direct service organization. So we don't directly service students or teachers or anything that's very direct service oriented. We are the city's Cradle to Career partnership. We're a collective impact partnership. And what that means is that we work with all of the organizations that do serve kids and parents and families in the city. So we're really sort of like the backbone to helping all these organizations better understand what is it that they're doing, how are they delivering services to kids and families, and how can they do better, how can they improve. That's our area of expertise. No one on our team are trained educators. We are trained improvement experts, and you'll kind of see where how that comes into play along the way. So again, we work within the city of Albany. We have a leadership council. It's not called a board for very specific reasons that we don't have to go into today. But you'll come to understand we do this work in partnership with organizations. We can't do this work on our own, and so it's up to the organizations and institutions in our city to step up and work together with us. Ultimately, we're on this path, if you will, to something that we call systems change. So we do look at indicators, population level indicators regarding education. And what we're really looking to do is remake systems organized not around schools, but around children and families. And so what that means is that our ultimate goal, sort of our 60,000 foot view of the world, is to really end intergenerational poverty, which we know really deeply affects children and families and communities. The way we're looking at that and measuring ourselves is by 6 educational outcome indicators in the city. These include kindergarten readiness, 3rd grade reading, 8th grade math or Algebra 1 proficiency, high school graduation, post-secondary enrollment, and post-secondary completion. We're on the verge of adding a 7th outcome. That would be a workforce outcome. So you can tell that we span the entire cradle to career continuum. We're part of a national network. There are over 100 cities all across America who use this framework. It's a framework, not a model. You don't drop it in. It looks very different all across the United States. And we've been part of this network for a number of years now. And we can talk a little bit more about that as we go along. So as I mentioned, we hold ourselves accountable to these 6 population level indicators across the city. What that means is we're not looking for small change, we're looking for radical change, population level. That means 60% of your population would be trending in a specific direction or higher. This is where it leads us to work with organizations such as yourselves that actually serve a large number of children. Again, we're adding that 7th outcome indicator. We'll have to change this graphic when we get there. But what does that actually mean? Again, we don't do any service delivery, so we seek out partners who do deliver services to children and families within the city. So for tonight's purposes, and I'm happy to take questions about what we do in other areas of the pipeline, but this was really a project centered around 3rd grade literacy. And this is not going to be a tough sell. Literacy at the end of 3rd grade is obviously a critical milestone in a child's developmental career. We know that children who read on grade level at the end of 3rd grade, if you cannot read on grade level or proficiently, you are 4 times more likely to drop out of high school. I think you probably have all heard of the learning to read and then reading to learn. Literacy instruction drops off after 3rd grade, and that's where we start really picking up in content. So if you're a 3rd grader who moves on to 4th grade, unable to really read at that grade level, you start falling further and further behind. These are all kind of well-known things. Nationally, we know that about 80% of low-income students finish 3rd grade unable to read on grade level. Some of you may have encountered the Campaign for Grade Level Reading. That's a national organization. They work on this issue nationally. Here in the city of Albany, our numbers look very similar. We have a 20% proficiency rate for 3rd graders within our city school district, so we're about at the national average. Diving down one layer deeper, there's something very specifically called summer learning loss that happens over the summer for young students. What we see is low-income students lose an average of more than 2 months in their reading achievement in the summer, while middle to high-income peers actually make gains. What you actually end up seeing in this chart over here, especially in the first years, students can end up years behind, even if they're making the same level of gains as their middle and high-income peers during the school year. Because if every year you're falling behind 2 to 3 months, that ends up compounding itself over the years. So summer learning loss, huge issue, nationwide issue. It's not something that's just here in Albany. What can help reverse this is summer programming, of course, that engages students during the critical time. It can help prevent, reduce, or reverse the summer learning loss. There are a lot of factors that impact how effective summer programs are at actually doing these. And one of the questions that was raised, and I'm glad Scott put it out there, is one of the questions that Scott brought to us when we first started working together is, can we start to measure the impact of the summer reading program that Albany Public Library puts out in terms of having an effect on the summer learning loss? So this was one of the questions that we started off with. I want to talk to you a little bit about our model for improvement. This is really important to how the work actually gets done. I'm sort of embarrassed to say this, but we haven't invented anything new. We're really borrowing from the last 150 years of process improvement. If you've ever done Six Sigma, if you've ever done Lean, if you've ever done CQI, it's all the same kinds of things. You're pulling from the same improvement science. And really what that is, in a very simplified way, is we're trying to answer these three questions that you see on the left. What exactly are we trying to accomplish, and defining that in a very narrow term? How will we know that this change that we're making is an improvement? Because the last thing we would want to do is spend a lot of time and energy and dollars and all this kind of stuff and not know if anybody is better off or not. And the third is, what change can we make that will result in improvement? If we're unhappy with a certain level of performance, which I think we probably all agree that a 20% literacy rate isn't where we want to be, how will we change, how can we make a change, and how will we make sure that that results in improvement? This PDSA model, if you've ever done continuous improvement work, will seem very familiar. And we'll walk through how we use this model specifically in this project with Albany Public Library. So the first phase of a plan, do, study, act is obviously to plan. We started talking pretty significantly with Albany Public Library this last spring. And the key activities that we did is we looked at the data collection from the year before, and we looked at what was the performance level of the 2016 summer year, and we did some analysis on that, which we'll share that with you in a second. We really focused in on the project aims of really defining what it is we wanted to see, and by we, I really mean the APL leadership wanted to see change. Building consensus and reaching agreement to lead an improvement project to test a change. This requires a lot of leadership. It requires a lot of staff time and effort. And so we, as a principal, we won't invest our time as Albany Promise unless we've got sort of the high-level leadership buy-in, which Scott really helped us manage at Albany Public Library. We enter into a formal commitment to the project with a partnership agreement and a data sharing agreement. And we also spent some time recruiting the appropriate partners. In this case, for this project, included the City School District of Albany and the Albany Housing Authority. And we enter into data sharing agreements with those partners as well as necessary. So you can tell there's a lot of planning work that has to go into this for us to be able to do this. In 2016, the summer reading program served 956 unique students. And so the team at Albany Public Library looked at this and set a goal to increase participation to 1,200 students. They brainstormed up the following changes that they were going to implement into the summer reading program to reach this goal. It included establishing a new pre-registration process, beginning recruitment of students earlier in the spring and summer. They identified target schools for increased collaboration, and they worked more closely with the school district. We worked with Albany Housing Authority to recruit participants or kids to be part of the program. And we also instituted weekly data reporting to help the administration at APL and the branches know how they were doing along the way, because we didn't want to just wake up 9 weeks later and say, wow, we really didn't hit our goal. That was no good. In the due phase, this began in mid-June when the summer reading program started until mid-August when the summer reading program ends. Obviously, the Albany Public Library staff implemented the changes that they outlined. They ran the summer reading program for 8 weeks, which is not a small task all across the city. And we held weekly data check-ins to see the trends in enrollment and see where we were going. This work is, you know, sometimes exciting, sometimes not. So half of it was, I believe, Scott in the owl suit, working closely with our local elementary schools. This was the end of school. I can't remember.
This was Delaware.
Delaware Community School.
Wait, you're actually in the owl suit there?
Yes. Scott was.
I really would like to not have
I'm
this.
I'm sorry.
Like
Scott wears
I feel like
the
I
owl
that
suit.
Everybody. Right? So this was part of the increased collaboration with the schools. They set up days where right at the dismissal, the OWL would be there, the OWL specifically, would be there recruiting and talking to the kids and parents about participating. And this very exciting second picture just tells you a little bit about these weekly check-ins that we would have with the senior leadership team about where each branch was, how we were progressing towards the goal, rather being 30-minute conversations every week. So that really got us to our study phase. The key activities in this phase was really Albany Promise has a full-time data team staffed with senior data researchers. They do the final number crunching. So we analyzed the results and compared the changes to last year. We did have to await student data to come in to analyze the results about could we actually see an impact in summer slide. And we also did some reflecting and summarizing of what we learned. I'm often asked, like, which part of this cycle is the most important, and I'm not supposed to say I have a preference. But truthfully and honestly, where I see folks really make improvements is if they take the time in this study phase to not blow through this and to really think about what did we learn, not just tangibly, but what were the biggest things? Were we surprised by anything? What came up that we just weren't thinking about or weren't looking for? This is a really important phase. So what you have here and may have in front of you is the results. They're divided out by branches, and then there's totals across the bottom. You will see that there were fewer registrants in 2017 than there were in 2016. There were several reasons for this, and there were very specific branches where we saw decreases. Another goal that was outlined but we weren't able to measure was we wanted to, the staff at Albany Public Library wanted to see increased levels of participation. So essentially answering the question, if we have every child in the city registered but never come back, is that really worth it? The way that participation was tracked from 2016 to 2017 were very different, so we couldn't do a comparison. But you can see across these numbers, you can see the comparison between the kids who came back and registered 120 minutes of reading and the 600 minute mark, and these are percentages of kids who actually reached those benchmarks. Oops, sorry. So that gives you a little sense of how 2017 was engagement-wise.
Juliet, I have a question. So the number of registrants, this is limited to third grade or rising?
Nope. So this was anyone who participated.
Okay.
Yep, anyone who participated. In the targeting strategies, when the group picked out specific schools that they wanted to work with, they did specifically reach out to elementary schools and in talking with them did identify this, you know, really important K through 3 group.
Okay.
But these are all participants of summer reading.
Thanks.
Yep. Which begins at 5 and ends at 18? I might be wrong on that. Upper number. In the reflection period, we structure our reflection periods very structured, and we do what's called a plus delta. A plus is something that you would identify as went really well during this project or improvement cycle. A delta is something that you would change. So one of the pluses, the many pluses, the team felt really good about having set a goal, that there was a clear direction for where the summer reading program wanted to go that year. The simplicity and uniformity of the program across the library system. You may have to jog my memory here, but I think one of the things that got brought up was by having a uniform goal and a uniform way of reporting, everyone was very clear on what was expected across the entire system. This team felt that the program was more literacy-oriented than it was in previous years. They really enjoyed the whole library approach that we had to involve all staff and all departments along the way so everybody knew what was going on. And the data collection process and the move to thinking not just about participation but actually outcomes was also highlighted as a plus. The deltas, the team felt like there could have been more consistent communication within the library. The time frame of the program, we identified possible changes of when this starts and stops. We talked about that a little bit. The recruitment of participants always feels like there's room for improvement there. The public library internal planning process and ensuring it's an all-age program. We do see clustering in terms of ages of those who participate. one, I think being the biggest gain in registration comes as the program kicks off. So really wanting to get the biggest bang for your buck there and really thinking through what does that mean and then how do we structure program kickoffs with that in mind. In the partnership with the district this year, we use the SNN system, which I don't actually know what it stands for, but it's the direct...
School notification.
Thank goodness someone's here to answer that. It's the email system the parents sign on to, and so there were two SNN blasts across the summer, and we did see registration and participation notch up when that happened, so that was great. It was noted that the lack of kickoff events at certain branches really showed in their registration numbers, so this kind of loops back to the first point. The summer camps, various different kinds of summer camps, did not participate as much as they had in previous years. For various reasons, that was clear and so noted. The lack of connection to summer programming put on by schools, which would really revolve around summer school and things like that. And there was some anecdotal evidence again, that showed the intensity of the participation increase this year. Again, we couldn't do an apples-to-apples comparison, but anecdotally, through the staff at the branches and through the prizes, actually, which ended up being sort of a proxy, we saw some increases there. So in our partnership with the city school district, we talked to this district and said, you know, would you guys be willing to allow our data team to actually match up identifiers of students in an aggregate way to try and see, can we actually find a connection between participation in this program and the reduction in summer slide? Dr. Ken Robin is our senior research lead on this at the Center for Human Services Research at the University of Albany, analyzed this student data for those who participated in the summer reading program. Amongst participants, the intensity of participation, which was measured by the number of cards that were turned in, it was not related to summer change in test scores. The participants themselves were of a higher achieving group compared to their peers, but the spring to fall change in test scores did not differ meaningfully between the two groups. The participants in the program were compared to a group of peers who had similar demographic characteristics. This is a tool that data scientists use to try and match students to like students to see was there a change. And they're also matched up to students who had similar reading abilities when they were tested before the summer. So it's not a control group, but it gets to that notion of amongst kids who participated and didn't, can we see a difference? And ultimately, the finding was whether students participated in the summer reading program or not. The testing in the fall did not indicate any noteworthy loss or gain in either reading or math ability. And we'll talk a little bit more about how the findings led to these next steps in the ACT phase. This is sort of ongoing. We, again, as I said, just finished the analysis. So we're here to share what we've learned. There's also plans within Albany Public Library to share back with all of the teams that were involved. Some of the learnings, deciding on next steps. We often characterize this with the three A's. Do you want to adapt this approach? Do you want to adopt it and say it worked perfectly, now we just have to take it to scale? Do we want to abandon completely, this was not good, we don't want to ever try this again? And this team really chose to adapt, and I'll get into that sort of next here. So using the findings from 2017, the team has decided to make some programmatic changes, such as partnering more intentionally with other partners, beginning the planning process earlier. There was quite a list of things that the team wanted to start in January. We've started some state and national research on our end of Albany Promise to see if other public libraries have implemented other changes or have had other successes with summer reading program. As you all know, this is a state and national phenomenon that goes on at public libraries. The team was very adamant about the addition of a parent survey in this next round for this next summer, so we'll be working on that. And as I mentioned, we'll be starting in January this year to plan for the summer reading next year. And Albany Promise is happy to serve in the same capacity for summer 2018 and repeat some of these. Ooh, sorry, that went really fast. To repeat another improvement cycle. So there is an overview. I know it was a lot. I'm from the Midwest. I talk awfully fast.
20% of low-income students in the city or all students in the city?
No, that's all students in the city.
Attending public schools?
Yes.
Attend a city school district?
Yes.
Do we know what the, I'm sorry. Do you know what similar school, like other school districts' proficiency rates are?
Yeah, so we're an urban serving district. Yeah. We are not unlike many other school districts,
okay,
both across New York State and across the country. This is about average, yes. Just a point about the low income piece. A lot of this research about low income reading proficiency was done prior to a federal change in the free and reduced lunch program. So the free and reduced lunch program is actually administered out of the FDA, and previously it required parents to disclose financial information to say, you know, is this child? It was always a really bad measure of family income, to be very frank, but in recent years, really great changes have happened, and that has been the understanding in federal administrations that if you're a school district that serves over a certain percentage, and I believe this percentage is 70%, there's always a free and reduced lunch kids. There's always a percentage of kids who are not returning those forms. So what is the point of telling one student you are not eligible for free lunch and you are? So the FDA actually has gone and offered to states and cities, if you are over this percentage, we will do an all, what they call an all district option. And so Albany Public Schools has opted into that. I say all of this to say, it's a tweak in the data now because we have less accurate data about family income than we used to. It used to be a bad measure, but it was something, and now it's sort of altogether, the incentive to return that form is altogether gone.
Yeah.
And that's a really, I shouldn't have gone that much into detail,
no,
but it's an important kind of piece to understand about how we measure.
Conclusion you came to about the not change in the FWE scores, does that mean there's no summer slide?
No, that was for the students who participated in the program.
So for the students who participated in the program, there was no slide?
No, there was no reduction in the slide.
So it was the same?
They had the same. So a student who did attend a summer reading and a student who did not, there was no difference in the amount of slide that we saw.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
As compared to their peers based on
a similar peer group.
And our last question, you guys have some questions too. So the metrics that you were tracking, is this also from Scott? Are you going to continue to track those same metrics over time?
In
so like the intensity of reading, so that you can compare that over time.
Yeah, we're not going to drastically change that.
I'm sorry, you have to speak up. I can't hear.
We're not going to drastically change the program so that we can have a good apples to apples comparison.
So I noticed you used the word intensity a couple times, specifically on slide 19, I think. Is it fair? Maybe 18. I'm not good at math.
Okay.
That's
okay.
There should be a summer math program for adults.
I
would
be enrolled in that. So.
There's a difference between frequency of participation and intensity of participation, right? Is that a measurable? Is that something based on the data that was being collected? That there's a measurable distinction in between frequency of participation and intensity of participation?
Yeah, that's a really great question, and the answer is no, unfortunately. Mostly because it's a self-reported program.
Mm-hmm.
And there was actually a really interesting finding, is there was some gradient. There were kids who sort of participated and turned in maybe the first two cards, and I'm gonna blank on the numbers of minutes that were on the first two. And then most of the kids sort of were in this middle bulk. So they maybe, you know, maybe it was like 200 or 400, and then there was just a couple that ended up doing this, like, you know, turning in every card from, you know, now till Sunday. It's self-reported, and so that's a really mushy kind of variable to look at. It's the best we we have, and I think in this case, we would not, are from a data collection standpoint, now I'll speak for Dr. Ken Robin, even though I usually never do, we would not argue that we should go to some great lengths, right? Because at some point, it's just inappropriate, and it wouldn't deliver. It's a little easier when you're, you know, doing analysis on programs where you do have that very specific, like, attendance, and then number of hours, and then, you know, over time, you can get a little bit more nuanced. That's where you'll actually find the best findings as it relates to mentoring, actually, because you get at that intensity piece, and that becomes, frankly, the watershed of, like, this doesn't work versus this works, is the intensity and duration. So again, a little too much nuance, but it was a great question.
Thanks. I have one follow-up that I'll be quick about. Were there any findings based on the reportable information and frequency of participation throughout the program that was surprising based on particular demographics or the location in which children were going to participate in this program?
The most, not really. I think the most clear participation indicators we saw was if they reached that first, if they ever returned a card. So we did have a group of kids who registered and never came back to return a card. Once they returned a card, they were sort of equally likely to be in any of those other buckets. But that first card was definitely, we lost some kids. And by that I mean they did not return cards. No children were lost.
How many third graders are reported in this study, and how many third graders are there in the whole city school district?
So I knew someone was going to ask me that. That's a great question. So this question always comes up as well, I think, for Albany Promise, and it's worth clarifying. Is that we do work very closely with the City School District of Albany, and we have a really great working relationship. It does not mean that we are closed off to working with charters. Charters are public schools as well. I've only been at Albany Promise for the last 26 months, I believe, and it's something that I really like to, we have some of the secondary charters at the table, the high schools. We'd like to get to that point. Right now, there are just limitations based on who's at the table and who's willing to, you know, share data. And again, as I mentioned, every single project goes to the district for approval, so it's not like a willy-nilly kind of thing. So, I'm going to be able to find this. This is like my magic trick here. So, there were 865 students who participated in the program. 41% actively turned in at least the level one card, which was the 120-minute mark. So that gave us, that left us with 357 students. 73% of those were city school district students. So that gives you a sense the majority are in the city school district who participated in the program. This, again, when you look population level, the majority of students who live in the city do attend the City School District of Albany. So that wasn't too surprising. Then 75% of those students had a valid fall NWEA score, and then 90% of those had a valid spring score. So again, we have to have those two benchmarks. So that left us with 176 students who we could run the analysis on. And it was a pretty representative group. Ken felt comfortable with that. It wasn't skewed in any specific way. But yes, I mean, any kind of analysis like that faces all of those sort of drop-off points.
So there's 176 third grade students who attended.
Those were students.
Nope, sorry, those were all students.
Yeah. Not third grade.
Yeah. Not just third grade.
So, but this study was about third grade?
Yeah.
So we're looking specifically, the outcome that we look at is that third grade reading rate. To actually look at, not just third graders take this NWEA, so it's K through 8. When we looked at who participated, there was clustering around the age groups of K through 5. After 5th grade, we saw not so many students participate. To note, they're not specifically just third graders. where that we know and research shows at the end of the day that reading on grade level by the end of third grade propels you forward.
When we did the pushes and the who we were targeting, that age group is the ones we targeted specifically,
mm-hmm.
but it was still open to the other age ranges. So they, when they looked at the scores, they did all K through, essentially K through 8,
yeah.
scoring wise. But when we did our push, so I think there was one breakout, I think, by grade.
There was, I know, and I probably have it. We at least did it by age. Yep, significant drop off after sixth grade, actually. And the bulk being between first and sixth grade, but the bulk really being grades 1, 2, and 3. Third graders were actually our highest participants. They accounted for 15% of the program participants.
So we need to move the agenda along. Are there any other last questions?
Is there any specific reason for the drastic change in numbers of participants at library branches between from this year to last year? In one of the first slides you had up there, I saw some rather large changes.
Yeah, and I would also kind of say, if I'm forgetting anything, but the things that jumped in mind were staffing changes that had happened, I want to say, right before.
Yeah, it was like within 3 weeks of the start of Summer Reading Club, we had a couple major staffing changes that the staff who were running Summer Reading Club left us.
Okay.
So they...
A couple different branches?
At a couple different branches.
We also saw a significant reduction in, like the YMCA does a camp, they weren't coming to our Delaware branch. So that reduced it. We also saw a significant drop in sign-ins. We've seen one every year at Delaware Fest, and this year we had that kind of micro storm for Delaware Fest, and we saw a significant drop. But the branches where we saw the biggest decreases were the Hal branch and the North Albany branch, and both of those are the branches that had significant, not just staff changes, but with Hal, there were some emergency things that went on that the staff needed to dedicate time and energy on something else.
And now that I'm reminded about the YMCA changed their programming structure, and so they went from holding something, I'm going to get this wrong, but like sort of on their own, and then they could sort of decide as they went to a different model where they were actually pushing into some schools and some other things. So, and I think this is just a great example, and this kind of gets back, and I promise I'm wrapping up, right, this kind of gets back to the concept of collective impact, and it again, it's not just on the schools. Like this literacy rate or whatever else you want to go, it's not just a right, it's everybody's responsibility, and so this was a really, I think, courageous effort for the library to come and say, you know, we own this too, and so how are we engaging? But of course, there's complexity to it. So if someone else changes their behavior, like the YMCA, that all of a sudden you can see that, and so that helps us think about, okay, well then, what does next year look like? And does that mean we need to kind of go to the big summer school programming early on and say, hey, what are you guys doing? Can we figure it out? Right. This is continuous improvement is not meant to be a single point in time assessment of anything, right? It's meant to say, how can we better understand a really, really complex ecosystem? How can we over time get better and better? And how can we do more for those that we want to serve? It's not meant to be an evaluation. There's a big reason we don't use that word. It's not meant to point fingers. It's meant to say, how can we understand? How can we do better in a really productive way and not punitive fashion or anything like that. So, yeah, sorry. That was a long way to answer that question.
I have a question. So, in national research, do we know why that slump happens?
The summer slide?
Summer slide.
So, the best, I'd point you in the direction of the campaign for grade level reading. They're sort of a organizing institution, so they have a lot of research on their website specifically about summer slide. And what you see is furthering sort of inequities, right? So families who are from middle and high income brackets can afford to send their children to camps or to summer programming and these kinds of things where there's a high level of program quality. And so it's in some of the, in actually estimated that they gain 2 months of reading and I believe 1 month of math. You'd have to double check me on that. Whereas low-income families may not have the resources to do that.
So you're talking about programming. You're not talking about necessarily kids sitting down and reading books. You're talking about social interactions and
a combination of both.
Problem solving and
a combination of both, right? Like reading, learning to read is a combination of yes, absolutely being in front of a book, having a reading instructor, those kinds of things. But it also, right, it hangs on a bigger, more broad understanding of the world and being able to connect concepts.
This has far-reaching. It says a lot, and it's very interesting. And we can't. Advocates show up on library lobby day and say, you know, we address the summer slump, you know, and we hope we do, but you know, we've got to figure out how we really are doing that in order to be able to say that.
Yeah, absolutely, and I would say, you know, you're not alone. We currently are running 21 improvement projects with lots of different partners all across the city. Again, this is not education-based. This does not have to come from a school building. This comes from public libraries. This comes from pediatricians, right? What are pediatricians doing? How could they do something better? Local colleges, right? Everybody has a seat at this table. Everyone has a responsibility. And the move, what you're talking about, is the move to outcomes. Can we really demonstrate? Can we know for a fact that the programs and services and whatever else we are saying we're doing are really showing outcomes for kids?
So through the national network, are there other library studies that you can link ours to so that if there are people who are seeing improvements, we can learn from them?
Yes, so that was one of the requests from the APL team. We did reach out to the national network. I've had several conversations, and I have another 2 scheduled. I'd be happy to have Scott report back on those findings.
But there's not much.
Yeah, I didn't know how much Scott wants me to say. In the preliminary conversations I've had, to your point, there's a lot of we think. There's not a lot of, can we actually look and see? I don't mean to overstate this. I really feel like Albany Public Library was awfully brave in saying, like, we're really going to hold ourselves accountable here. And when you do that, we don't always have good outcomes, right? We don't always have good news to deliver. Again, you're not alone. But in the conversations that I have had a lot of really great conversations about we do this. And then when I ask that critical question of, and how are you linking yourself back to student level outcomes? I've heard a lot of, well, we don't do that. Mm-hmm. So there's a critical, you know, culture change that has to happen in our society to get these population level numbers to move. As you were asking me, these numbers in an urban area of high poverty and intergenerational poverty are not outside of the norm. So, sorry.
No, that
was
really
answer.
It's
thank you so much.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks.
So we met on November 21st, 2017. We had some members of the public who came to speak on behalf of keeping the library open. During our meeting, we looked at some results of the community forums, where 35 people attended, and then there were some surveys that were given out. Again, we looked at the responses from the surveys about what people were looking for, mostly picking up books and materials, asked questions from the library staff, and then we talked about where do we go from here, and we talked about the fact that we need to engage community to explore some options, have a community advisory group, have some conversations with the YMCA, the City Department of Recreation, Albany School District, and talk also citywide to see what the whole city would like to see happen. And then we had some more public comments. Are there any questions?
Do we have a time frame for those next steps?
Some will occur when the discussion happens.
I'm sorry, was there a timeline for community planning? What did you call it, a community?
Advisory.
Is that what you just answered?
I'll talk louder.
Yeah, I gotta speak louder too. When we do the discussion, if I can have a couple of minutes to talk about what we've done since this last meeting from an organizational level.
Absolutely. All right. And then, actually,
Planning Committee.
Yes, that's also mine. So we met the day before on the 20th, and we discussed the 5-year plan and budget modifications, and then also about having to have a meeting because of the early December meeting here, that we need another one just to be able to close out the books. Are there questions about that?
Sorry, will the late December meeting be like pop in, vote, and go?
Yes.
It will be quick. Yeah.
It's just the voter.
We try not to have any public meeting or pop in.
Yes, sorry.
We don't think it will be, the agenda will not be long.
Okay.
Any other questions about either of those? Okay, great. Policies and procedures, Chris.
As we didn't meet this month because we're up to date, I just reflected that in the grid. So we'll be resuming meetings in January. But we're pretty much up to date on all.
My report. So Albany Public Library was well represented this year at the annual New York Public Library Association Conference held in Saratoga Springs. Not only did several staff members attend, but many presented and volunteered, and there was a significant amount of positive feedback around. I heard of standing room only for Mary, former President Mary Ellen Pichet, and Rebecca Smith Aldrich's program on lean management. Washington Avenue branch has Minecraft programming going in full swing. They get packed every day that they do this program. Arbor Hill West Hill has kind of adopted something that Washington Avenue has done for years, and it's hosting a variety of service providers. Health insurance companies, Capital District EOC, Keys for Kids, letting them set up a table so when you walk in the door, they can provide information. The Pine Hills branch, a volunteer-led art group, has gained a significant amount of momentum. And also Pine Hills Youth Services staff and full staff partnered with the school librarians from Albany High and had a successful library lock-in program. That's where this picture actually comes from. It was really a great time. I was only here for a short period of time, but 60 students participated, and it seemed like overall a successful event. A patron at our Delaware branch was very excited to let staff know that she got a job, and that's always really positive to hear. The Howe branch hosted a multi-session workshop offered by Cornell Cooperative Extension called Strengthening Families, and it's about communication skills and having fun together. Really kind of a heartwarming kind of program. And then the North Albany branch continues to have a popular adult book club, I think in the evenings. Facilities has been busy preparing for the winter. You'll notice our truck now has the plow on. IT continues to work on system-wide printing issues, but they feel they've had them resolved. And our public information officer handled several inquiries from the media, first about North Albany, and then CBS6 did a story about our teen informational posters that hang in all of our bathrooms, but they focused on the Bach branch in particular. In terms of development, the Friends and Foundation merger talks continue to move along. Art at APL has planned its first show beyond Pine Hills, and this is a really kind of cool idea. The Arbor Hill Young Artist Showcase will be a 3-week exhibition of works by 5 Albany teens. This was spearheaded by our Arbor Hill West Hill Community Engagement Clerk. And Opening night will coincide with Albany First Friday in April, which is April 5th. And other than that, the bargaining agreement, or our contract, has been signed by all parties. An email went out earlier today, we got the PDF yesterday. The PDF, if you want to look at it, we can make a print copy. Typically, we wait for the union to do their print copy, but we might be able to run you some. However, you can find it in that attachment in the email, in the shared folder, Google folder, and also there's a link to it on the Board of Trustees portal.
Scott, did you say April 5th?
April 5th.
April 5th is a Thursday.
April 6th.
April 6th. And that's it for my report. I'll take questions. You guys are scaring me.
Well, congratulations for outstanding presentations. That I heard from other people how great the NYLA presentation was. So it's just great to be cutting edge for APL to, you know, teach the rest of the field there. That's great. Congratulations on that. And Scott's testifying next week for the Library State Assembly Committee on Libraries. Can't wait to hear that. You were great last year, so we're looking for
that. Last year, I reread last year's, no, I don't know if I can top this, but we'll see. We'll see.
We have a great advocate in. Yeah, well, your chair now, I think, is pretty good.
She's pretty good. I feel like she seems to like a lot of things.
Mm-hmm. She's smart.
In the bullet points, it mentions renegotiating the cycle lease. What is involved in that?
So they were not really using the office upstairs, and we had some librarians who really needed an office upstairs. So they agreed to give that space up so we could provide staff some more kind of more private office space. And on the flip side, they are expanding their program because it's done so well, and they're buying a lot more bikes. So they're actually using a significant more space in the basement. So we just kind of have to readjust.
Oh, I see. I thought it had something more to do with the bikes. It's where they're going to, the people are going to sit.
No, our basement's going to be full of bike share bikes by, I think, by March.
Thank you.
Is anything changing with Youth FX?
They're moving to, that's always been a temporary setup.
Oh, I was wondering, I just heard that today.
And they will be moving. Hopefully, they think Friday. They were actually supposed to move before the end of the month. We gave them a little bit of a stay. They need to work on COs, but they should be out by.
Were they renting, or was that a?
That was like a user agreement. They gave us a little bit of money for the electric, but it was not substantial.
So what are we going to use? What are we going to do with that small meeting room?
I want to give Dan a break before we start thinking of any crazy ideas. For right now, it'll just go back to being an auditorium. However, there have been some ideas floated around, including if the Penn Studio is to stay in Washington Avenue branch, maybe moving that studio to the first floor so it's more noticeable, usable, and staff can observe activity within it to make sure that it's following our guidelines for the future.
Right, with the glass doors, maybe.
Yeah, I think if you walk, and I know this is a bad example, because of what's going on with Bethlehem, but if you walk into the Bethlehem Public Library,
you see it.
You see it as soon as you walk through that front door. It's there, it's noticeable, they actually have the live stream of it on the wall. So to me, that makes a lot more sense. We've also talked about the fact of incorporating it into Albany Made, because we do a lot of audio recording and we do a lot of video recording. So if it's a shared space, which would make sense since they're not paying any rent, a shared space that both groups can reserve and use. So when Sarah and Ryan do our podcast, they're not hiding in the history room. They're actually in a studio.
Yeah.
They don't have to waste a lot of time. So if we're done with questions, I just want to address patron comments from the last board meeting. We started doing that last meeting, and just some things just to show we're actually looking into some of the issues that these individuals from the public have brought up. The gentleman who brought up Yahoo.com, this is a known issue, not just APL, But for all internet users, the site takes up a lot of system resources. My guess is because they do a lot of video advertising with their site. The problem was it improved when we expanded bandwidth, but has not gone away entirely. Next year, when we negotiate our contract with Lightpath, we will be increasing bandwidth and re-examining our network architecture. Right now, the way we're designed is a little bit behind the times. All of our internet traffic goes through Washington Avenue and then out. We think it might be better to just have it directly leave from the building. As for the local history office hours, due to staffing limitations, we cannot at this time expand hours, although we constantly talk about it. However, after talking with Jim, who is our local history librarian, he has started doing appointments with the members of the public. So if you do want to come in on a Saturday, a staff member will get you in the room, get you set up. This is actually a model a lot of local history rooms follow due to staffing, because we don't have the staffing to have that room staffed all the time. It is where some of our most valuable items sit. So we definitely need a librarian or a library assistant in there. And then book sale. The library does two book sales every year, one at Delaware Fest and one here at the Madison Upper Street Fair. And the Friends are very excited to report the Friends are now doing a small book sale at their Tuesday book talks. So we're developing a book sale kind of program, and we hope that it can get as big as Schenectady and make us $100,000 a year. And that's it.
Careful with those.
Any other questions? Okay, so moving along to the update on the North Albany branch.
So just some North Albany updates. Based off of my meetings, I kind of had a list of individuals that I was going to call and either have a meeting with or ask for some assistance. I spoke with Common Council Kelly Kimbrough on 11/24, requesting suggestions for community members for the North Albany Advisory Committee. He's working on those names for me. I'll probably give him a return phone call and just say, you know, we'd like to get some names, we'd like to reach out, I really would like this being something we start in January. On 12/1, I met with Commissioner Jones from Albany Recreation Department about possibilities for some partnerships for programs in North Albany. He had a lot of great ideas. We talked about STEM education, which he has some funding for. They recognize, and this is what I'm saying to a lot of organizations, we seem to be doing a lot of people's work in that neighborhood, and therefore we need to start getting people to chip in a little bit to help us out. On the 14th, I spoke with her today, but I will be having, on 12/14, I will have open office hours at the branch. We will do a better job of publicizing it. I know we've done a flyer, and we're going to talk to the YMCA about promoting that. I spoke with the school principal today, and I will be meeting with the principal in North Albany. I think it's 12/18 is the date that we agreed on. For the next ad hoc committee, I'll be working. There seemed to be some confusion from our last meeting about kind of the timeline and why things developed the way they did. So I'm going to go through my notes, and I'm going to have a nice timeline for this committee to see where kind of the conversation started, which was with the facilities committee looking at other spaces in that building, and how it kind of grew out of that conversation and then ramped up with the bug issue. And I also want to note that the Albany County budget was voted on today and passed, and there is zero money in that budget for public libraries or the Albany Public Library.
Thank you. You were not expecting that, were you?
No, but we had conversations.
Does that break in any way from recent past?
No. No, then never.
Any comments, questions, concerns?
So I didn't hear in there the. Are there any actions for a community advisory committee?
Yeah. What I'm doing is I'm polling members of the community, so I speak with the school principal. She can identify some people.
I see.
And then I'd really like this to be something led by the committee, not by staff. So what I'm looking for is, we don't really have a chair for this committee because it's an ad hoc committee, but we do need someone to take a little bit of ownership of this, because I feel like, as we've felt from public comments, that there is a misunderstanding about why this conversation is being driven, and I think it might be more nuanced if a board member does it as opposed to a member of the staff.
Okay.
answer your question, but that
no.
raise more.
Yeah.
So
you think maybe like in a month?
In a month, hopefully. We're looking for names, but we're also looking for somebody from the community to step up and say they're really going to take the reins on this and kind of reach out to the people and schedule things so that, you know, it's a little bit less staff-driven, a little bit more board and community-driven.
Well, okay. I do think staff has to be involved.
Oh, staff will be involved.
Yeah.
Staff involved. We'll be in the passenger seat, but we're not going to, we don't want to drive the car. We think it would be better if board members or members of the community drive the car.
Okay. But in terms of coordinating it and, you know,
yeah.
doing the legwork, I think
we'll,
it really
we'll do
is
that,
helpful to have.
But in reaching out, we always see we get successful board members when other board members recruit them. I'd like to see members of the board having the conversation with these members from the community, saying we really need you on this committee. I don't want it to appear that we've handpicked people we know which
yeah.
will agree with
yeah.
one opinion or another.
That's completely understandable. Is there a neighborhood association in that neighborhood?
Yes.
Who's the head of that?
I cannot think of the person's name off the top of my head, but I'll find out who that is.
Yeah, a couple.
Yeah.
More than one neighborhood association?
A couple of neighborhood
associations, yeah. So they have the Tenants Association up on the hill. Yeah. And then they had a neighborhood association that dissolved, and then a year later a neighborhood association that popped up.
Do we know how far the library is from the border of Menands?
I don't know how far we are from the border of Menands, but we're under 2 miles from the branch. Their location, I drove it a couple days ago when I was there. So I want to say it's about 1 point, probably around a mile plus a little.
I think it's 1.8 out to that. And, but I noticed the hours of that branch.
Are terrible.
Mm-hmm. Which is probably why I put an answer saying the Bombay branch is much more convenient.
I might suggest to the group, I wouldn't want to do it because I'm only going to send them to Texas. It might be good for us to send a representative to their board meeting and talk about the issues that we're having and the fact that we're seeing a significant amount of their patrons using our location. And while we welcome everybody, it's again kind of making some issues. And just maybe they need to step up their game a little bit as well.
I just thought it was interesting in the report there that the comments, you know, are from folks from Colony.
Mm-hmm.
I get that they're serving as advocates for students, you know, either as teachers or something, but I just think it's, and people at that meeting, several of them were patrons of the Y, but they didn't live in the neighborhood. So that all concerns me. I mean, I was glad to hear from, was her Mary today?
Miss McCarthy, Mary McCarthy.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that I've conveyed to Kelly Kimbrough, the Honorable Kelly Kimbrough, a few times, that we would really like, we think it's great there's advocates from outside the neighborhood, but we really don't want to make a decision for a neighborhood until we start hearing from the people in the neighborhood.
Yeah.
And that is a concern of ours that I can see from the notes that were given tonight is being misconstrued as us not wanting to serve people from outside agencies. It's the opposite. However, when we're talking about a neighborhood, and this is where I become very Albany-centric, because I now live in a neighborhood that's affected by an organization that employs most of its people from outside the city, it's a frustrating conversation.
Yeah, it's disingenuous. They have their own library that they underfund. And I'm sick of people from certain population groups speaking on behalf of other population groups, thinking that, you know. Anyway, sorry, I'm thinking out loud.
To kind of go segue a little bit, this is an issue I think that's citywide. This
yeah.
is an issue that I think is happening with PEG. This is an issue that's happening with us. I think there's some impacts on the school district as well. And I think Albany Public Library has always kind of been a leader in this community, and you know that we may need to say that as a group.
Mm-hmm. I just have a question about the people who commented at the ad hoc meeting. They were from Colony, so this should this also be a conversation with the Colony
yes.
Library, not just Menands?
How However, that's a little trickier because they're a municipal library and they're already struggling as it is. However, this can be a conversation. If somebody wants to go to the Colony Board meeting and bring this up as well, that would be fantastic. I just think it would be inappropriate as the library director to step on somebody else's turf.
Mm-hmm. I grew up in Colony.
Well, I also think the conversation, the idea that we would be interested in closing a library, I don't think there's any one of us interested in closing a library. That's not our business.
No.
Our business is expanding services. So we can't even get to the conversation about expanding services because we don't have, you know, the flexibility necessarily to do that. The question is how to best serve, you know, everybody and weigh those pieces. But, you know, it occurs to me that this could be the lightning rod that does organize people in that community to say this is a valuable thing. It happened with the branch improvement plan. You know, a lot of those neighborhoods didn't have much to, they mostly fought each other about stuff, but when they could come together about the library, and they did, and it was, they were clear, and it was through those community forums or community advisory group.
I think you raise an important point, Melissa, that I raised at the meeting as well, which is it's appropriate for us to be having this conversation with Albany right now, and that's the first group population we had to need to have a conversation with. But it's not just a North Albany conversation, it's a citywide conversation, because no matter what we decide, it's going to impact the services of libraries in the rest of the city. And we need to figure out how to have that conversation as well. So it'll be a while.
Would it be crazy to suggest shared services with Bonanza if we have people and hours and they have space?
No, it's a good
really
idea.
It's a really good one. It's one that's been talked about in our shop a few times. They are another district. So a shared services agreement is something another library in our system is doing, and I'm interested. Really interested to see how successful that is. I think it might be. But that is something it's up to the board.
Well, we have to talk about it. I mean, because I'm concerned the message I'm hearing from Scott and staff about the how spread thin everybody in the system is, and I want to...
We want to focus on that. Yeah, I'm not on the ad hoc committee, so I don't have the
I think it's good to have all options on the table.
Yeah.
Sarah,
you had a question?
Yeah, to both of your points, Alyssa and Karen, and to what you guys were saying earlier, Jenna and Alyssa, I think I'm also a little concerned about the timeline of this decision. I know the committee was established, I believe, about 9 months ago, back in March. I know we've looked at a lot of data, we've heard firsthand accounts, we've been out in the community, we've taken a lot of steps already to educate ourselves about how best to serve North Albany. And I know that during our last ad hoc committee meeting, we did discuss having this advisory group to get more input on the situation. I do think we are getting hung up on the decision, and that's keeping us from seeing what we have to do after, because whichever way we go on this decision, whether we vote to keep the library open or close the library, there's a lot of important work that's going to follow each decision. If it's a vote to close the library, to close the branch, then we need an alternative service plan. If we're voting to keep it open, we're quickly approaching budget season, and we need to calculate the finances, because it's not just the rent increase. There are a lot of other things that go into the budget, and keeping the North Albany location open, like you just said, our staff is spread very thin. So there are a lot of considerations, and I think we need to start looking at the aftermath of both scenarios. I think that's really important.
Yeah. I totally agree with you, and also with the advisory group, having a group. I think the topic is just not open or closed, it's also to engage the community and see what they think and what options or what concerns they have, what solutions they may or may not have, what ideals they may bring forth. So we don't want to present it as we just want you to come here and say a yes or no. No, we want more out of the residents that live there. ideals do you have? If you say, okay, well, you need X, Y, and Z, help us move forward with the library and so that we all can have our needs met. So it's not just a yes or no type of environment or presentation that we want from the community.
And so if we need to, finalize the budget in February, we vote on it.
You vote on it in February. We vote on it in March. Yep.
So we need to be thinking about how we have a productive conversation, Brenda, in a month. Is that a possible thing? Is that something you think?
Probably not, but I don't, me personally, I don't see, this has been an ongoing issue, and now we just now bomb the community, so now it's, oh, you have to do it in 30 days. No, I don't feel it's going to be done in 30 days.
Well, you did start 2 months ago.
I said, and bomb the community.
Well, it's also helpful to look back and see that the community advisory group, there was a small window at the beginning for people to identify what they wanted in a library. And then there was a direct response from the design team actually to say, you know, this is actually what it might look like given these parameters, you know, what the population, the formula for good librarianship, you know, like this size library for this population with these things in it. This is kind of what it looks like. And then, you know, we sort of went from there, like people responded to that, and then there was a financial evaluation of that, and so it kind of went, it wasn't just this grand open thing. It was a very prescribed kind of back and forth so that people had things to respond to and we could go back out and say, okay, well, the thing that you're asking for is this amount of money. And, you know, are we able to do that? And that gives participants the ability to actually have be able to evaluate it. Is this worth what we're talking about? So I'm concerned that we think through the process of that community engagement, not just, you know, what do you want here, but then how are we going to respond to that?
Exactly. I think that's some of what Sarah was saying too, that it's a lot of work on your side.
What I heard Sarah say is that, you know, come to some decision and then someone comes after. But what I hear Alyssa and Brenda saying is, no, we need to do that work first, and then we can come to a decision. Is that
I would definitely like to do that work and then come to a decision. I think we've been running into some challenges doing it that way. I did attend both community forums at the North Albany branch, and I believe I asked that question at one point to the entire audience, and then I know many of us, if not all of us on the board, have had one-on-one conversations with residents. And I think we even saw this in feedback from our survey. A lot of people are getting hung up on, please don't close the library, so they're not giving us the what would you like to see from the library. We're having a hard time getting those answers, and I'm not sure how else to go about doing that. I definitely think at this point we've received a lot of information. We've received community input from the two forums, residents that have turned out at our last two board meetings now, our last committee meeting of the North Albany Ad Hoc Committee, as well as the online survey and the paper surveys in the library branch. And I know Scott has also had office hours at the library branch. So I feel like we've received a great deal of feedback from the community, as well as, like I said earlier, the numbers and statistics, as well as firsthand accounts from our librarians and our staff at that branch. I feel like we have a lot of information, and I'm not sure what additional information will come out of an advisory group that we haven't already considered. I'm definitely willing to listen to anyone and everyone who has anything to share, absolutely. Like I said, I'm just expressing some concerns on the timeline, and I think we do need to set a deadline for ourselves at some point when we're going to make this decision. And I think we definitely need to consider what the steps are going to be after the decision before, because I don't think anybody wants to see a gap in services like what Mary is saying. So I think we're all on the same page there. I just think it's very hard and time consuming to come up with plans for both outcomes before we make a decision. So I hate to say make a decision then come up with a plan, just kind of an efficient combination of both of those.
And also, one of the things that came up too is oftentimes to say, well, it will cost X amount of money for a new library. Well, really taking a look at that to see how much it really would cost. Not saying that we're going to put a block there, but oftentimes I get the feedback, and you know, I've heard Scott mention numbers sometimes saying it's going to cost X amount of money, but how do we know that, and why haven't we or could we look into that and really see, well, it'll cost X amount of money. Well, do we have space? If someone said, okay, well, we want a new library, well, how much would that cost? Do we have space for that? Is it any feasible buildings in that area? Because some of the suggestions or the concerns are not even feasible. So if we can get those out the way and say, okay, well, a person say, well, can we redo this building? Well, if that's not possible, then can we have some data or somebody really look into that and say, okay, well, that's not a feasible option. That's out the way. So I think that would make some of the engagement flow a little bit better, where we can move over from the yes or no, and some of the things are not feasible, and we get to some of the things that the community may want, maybe we can find a way to get it. But some of the ideals that people may have are maybe so far-fetched that you know, good and well, we can do it. So we can be ready and prepared to be able to say, well, okay, we want a new library right here, it's going to cost X amount of dollars, here's our data, here is whatever. They don't want the imaginary number and they want to see, okay, it's going to cost this, that, and the other. So I think that would help us move further along as well, if we can just eliminate some things that are not reasonable, not feasible. If there's no, a lot of times people think, oh, the land bank or rehab or whatever, whatever. If there's no building around there for that, then that's off the table and we can move on to the next thing. So we don't have to waste time on it.
And I'll be quick, and I apologize if other people have already got there and I'm late to the point. Sorry, I said I'd be quick. Is it possible that we've approached this from too fatalistic a starting point in our discussions with the community? Has it, because this is an area of the city that has felt the short shrift in terms of city services generally. So I wonder if we went in with too fatalistic an approach, and in some ways that's prevented people from engaging in the process because it becomes just one more, well, of course, this is what's happening in North Albany. This doesn't happen in the Helderberg neighborhood or in Pine Hills neighborhood. And I wonder if there's a blueprint from when you were doing the branch improvement plan that is more positive and opportunity cultivating?
Yeah, and that's kind of what I was getting at, that actually if we said to them, what do you want in library service? And then we came back with the 2, 3, 4 possible options with ballpark figures that perhaps, and to your point, that maybe some things are completely off the table because, you know, economically we can't do that. But what if the community, what if like the three top things were they wanted to be able to pick up books, they wanted access to computers, and they needed a meeting space? Okay, what if those three things came up? Well, those could be addressed in many creative ways, right? I mean, we haven't even begun to touch the surface of like what it would be like to have a van service or an outreach service and a location maybe in the school, or I don't know. I who knows what's a possibility, but we can't unleash your great creativity to figure that out because we don't know what they want. Now, it could be pie in the sky. Yeah, I want the fireplace, right? And you're like, okay, well, that we're talking about a $5 million building project. Is this city ready for, you know, another construction project for a library? Probably not. Okay. You know. So I think maybe that's it. Maybe we do that piece of it. It comes back to our staff to put plans together for various scenarios of how to provide the they call it the program. How do you provide the program? You can do it various ways.
I also deeply agree with Scott that I think the APL staff needs to be taken off the table and sidelined on this. And I'm sorry this didn't occur. You guys shouldn't be the face of this conversation, not because it's inappropriate, but because I think it wrongfully muddies all of the other great work that you're doing around the city. And now, I mean, you know, it's become, oh, North Albany's closing, and that's the story about Albany Public Library that's in the news, and that's deeply unfair to you guys. Yeah.
So what I'm hearing from Brendan, Melissa, and Mike, so I said, is a way to have the conversation. So to be fair, the conversation that was intended to be had at community forums was about what services you want. But the fatalistic attitude came out and said, don't hold the library. What do you want to see? And I do. It was hard to have the conversation. So perhaps, if it's more of an engaged conversation, where people are helped to understand the possibilities better, you know, more part of the process, that would enable a different kind of engagement, different kind of conversation. Is that what you're thinking, Brenda?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And then to Sarah's point, if you have two or three scenarios that you put out and you get feedback from, then we're in a position to be able to say, this looks more feasible, this one here, so we can make this decision in this way.
If I can speak, one thing I would absolutely love to do something like that, because that's, I keep saying, I want to build libraries, I don't want to close them.
Right.
However, we do have to, Mary's probably thinking this and channeling it to me, we have to think about the fact that if we do this work, it's going to cost money.
Yeah.
We will have to hire a firm, and that's, architects are not cheap. We could use the architect that we've used for a while, but even if we were to somehow get student volunteers and have it be a very community thing, we still need to have a lead architect so that when they give the numbers, those are the numbers. So that'll just have to be a cost that we'll need to factor in. That'll come out of next year's budget.
Well, I think we need to have good answers for why can't we just keep the status quo more than anything. I don't know that it has to be.
Well, that is one of the options, though.
Yeah.
It certainly is. And we could, mm-hmm. You know what, the community could come back and say, you know, this is really, we recommend that this is the best of all three options. And you know what, it could be compelling. If they are organized enough and they have organized themselves, and then we're able to go back to them and say, okay, you said you wanted this. Let's see how you know, we need participation. We need collaboration. We need partners.
Well, do you also need some statistics on the outcome of circulation and people using the library to keep it open?
Yeah, because what is
organized
enough?
That's what we're
right.
saying. I mean,
right.
It's kind of like a negotiation. Okay. That's what you want, let's do this. You know what, we did it with the branch improvement plan. We said, okay, if this is these are libraries you want, then we gotta get this thing passed. You gotta pass it.
Yeah.
And that's when, you know, other organizations and people stepped up and said, yeah, we'll help do that. And that really, like, it organized people.
Are we still talking about a community advisory group?
Yes.
Are we talking
yes.
about bring to the community, because I feel like we're having two different conversations here, that we're bringing these ideas and asking people what they want. And I feel like we did that with the surveys and the forums, and that's what we got from the community, but now we're going to have key people and ask the key people those questions and present them? Is that what you're thinking?
The advisory group from the community. So it's not Colony, it's not all these different people. It's going to be people from the particular that particular neighborhood who are affected, who care about that library. They have to step up to the plate and be a part of this process to help us make the right decision.
But then I also think I heard at the committee meeting that some of us were also thinking of having residents from throughout the city, because this is a citywide
Well, to Alyssa's point, then should we start, or I say we, but actually should the committee, the ad hoc committees, create metrics for what we would need to see to keep the branch open and what we would need to see for the branch to close? Like, these circulation numbers would mean we should keep the branch. You know, this promise from the YMCA for not increasing the rent for this amount of time would mean we should keep the branch. Like, I feel like we need some, like, you know, like three more books and we go to bed.
I would like to caution the group, though, about the what would you like? Because if you ask people what they'd like more than what they have. And then so that, that and they'd like a new building, and they like, or we purchase a building, we rehab the building. I don't know that we really have, well, you can see, I mean, if you test the waters throughout the city, I assume that the voters in Albany, feeling that they're overtaxed as it is, wouldn't be thinking that was a real feasible option. So that option, if you offer it, can be a can of worms that it's just going to be a rabbit hole of spending money, and then that's not going to be a feasible option for us. That type of thing, either staying at the Y or coming up with creative ideas of how to offer services, that those are more feasible.
And with the branch improvement program, of course, we had a vote, so we really got to see what the people in the city thought.
Yeah, we can't really have a, can we have a vote?
Well, we could think about it. Well, you could have a vote if we were to bond to build a new building.
Yeah.
And we could put across a budget for a new building and for all three different scenarios and put that up, and that would kind of be the referendum. Because we would present it as, this is the reason why we're asking for a 6% increase. It's to provide library services in North Albany. You could do it that way as well.
People are so smarting about what happened like
9 years ago. I am aware. I hear it every public meeting.
If that were to happen, would you definitely have to put it in North Albany, or would you put it someplace else in the city? And the other question is, do we really need, or can we really sustain another building and more people in our budget?
There's new building, but there's also
staffing.
No, not just staffing it, but there's a budget vote too, and you can think about what increase would be necessary to do what we want to do in North Albany. And so, not new building, but just existing, and if that is an increase that the city is willing to support, that would be some feedback.
And there's two things I want the board to take into consideration in this. Is one, part of the reason for this discussion is an exercise in our own budget and the fact that we do run a deficit. The fact that we are discovering with our 5-year facilities plan that we have some major building work coming to us in the next few years. We have to keep that in mind. And although $75,000 or $150,000 does not sound like a lot in a budget of $7 million. The reality of it is that's half of the deficit that we're going to run next year. So we have to take that into account, and also reallocating, because the other reason why this conversation moved forward is our concern about staffing at all of our locations. And although that's only 2.5 bodies to reallocate, it is still 2 people that, or a person that could be running a teen program at Arbor Hill after school, because our staff there right now are, they're drowning because they have such a high workload. And there's some danger, there's some security issues there. So that's the other idea of moving staff. How do we reallocate resources to shore up places which need staffing? And also we look at our budget and make some repairs to the fact that we're spending down our savings. So I don't think that should be the reason why we make the decision, but it is the reason why we're having the conversation for the decision.
Kind of shifting gears a little bit, I know part of the discussion in the North Albany neighborhood has been around limited internet access. I know the city of Albany has the Albany Freenet program, and the coverage areas, I believe I'm pulling up a map here, it's kind of, there seems to be a coverage in the Delaware area and around Washington. Is there any way we can talk to the city and see if they can get expand into the North Albany neighborhood, since we as a library are starting to see a trend in increase of e-reader and e-circulation and decrease in other circulation? I think if we could get internet access to that neighborhood, that would give us more options as a library how to provide services in that neighborhood.
Albany Freenet's been dead for a while. It's kind of a it's kind of a zombie network.
Gotcha.
So I was on the city's ad hoc broadband study committee that was some of the ideas put across, and I was hoping APL would be the lead agency in that. That seems to have stalled, so I'm not quite sure where we're at with that. But that's, you know, another idea, and it's another idea we've talked about, I've talked about since coming on board, which is I think we should be putting public Wi-Fi access points throughout the city. We were going to do it at the dog park, and it made the decision without telling us that we were no longer a part of that project. Some dog people objected to other people being on their phone while with their dogs. That is what it is.
I actually see a reason.
I do.
Because they don't want to pick up after themselves.
Yes.
I don't want their pit bull attacking my dog.
No, it's
our dog was attacked by
not
a dog.
Not pit
bull. Some of conversation.
Mm-hmm. So that's understandable.
That
the skate park was a whole folly of the electrician of the city has already left. He couldn't run the wire. We've not given up on the skate park, but there's no infrastructure right now, even though we've invested in some of the equipment. But I do think moving forward, being your point, is does Albany take over Freenet and maybe make it a more robust program? However, again, that's cost. And one of the reasons why Freenet failed is because there was no number to call when the service went down. There was no, you know, what we do with our public Wi-Fi, which is we control the bandwidth, we control how many people can be on. Because I would see it before Hal had Wi-Fi, everyone said, I'll just use Freenet, and then everybody tried to get on Freenet, and it never worked. So that's why we brought the Wi-Fi into that location 15 years ago. So that's a great point, and I would love to move forward on that. I just think there are significant players that we will have to meet with and talk to, that I've spoken to the board members to be helpful.
And some of the residents I know asked about Albany Freenet, because I have that at my house, but the residents across the street don't have it, so they inquired about why we can't have it and blah, 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 why can't it be upgraded or whatever. They went down City Hall. It was mentioned about the cost of the infrastructure. It is kind of strange because one house will have it, the next house wouldn't, and one house across the street will, and the next one would not. So
they had a dual model, which was free with ads and slow, and then you could actually pay like $6 a month. And what I think is some of those repeaters are just, again, it's a zombie network, and they're just, you know, full strength.
It works, but it just everyone doesn't have.
So I know that you requested leadership for the ad hoc committee. Is that something we vote at?
No.
Okay.
Because it's an ad hoc.
Even regular committees are designated by the executive committee. So something that, you know, somebody steps up and says, hey, I want to take this on because it is a big.
You have some interest?
Responsibility.
I'm not on that committee. I'm just volunteering other people right now.
You could get on that committee just like
that. Yeah.
Amen. Someone has to convince my husband to drop out of the band.
You know, buses are everywhere. What if CDTA had a supportive, roving, wireless... no, this...
You followed the bus.
This is a... thing. Bus routes are overlapping, and if the signal was strong enough, there'd be coverage almost always, many hours a day.
They have also offered to provide us a retired bus for a bookmobile.
Oh, that's awesome.
So we have a source for a bookmobile, and we finally kind of
provide a free.
They jump all over.
They would give it to
big purple bus.
You're gonna paint it purple?
Of course.
Not purple.
Can we put a big owl?
They may not maintain it for us, but they, and I really shouldn't talk about this on camera, but they have said we could probably do a maintenance deal with them, which would be substantially cheaper than when the bus was running.
Okay, this was North Albany, so.
Good option.
But I think, you brought up the last part of the conversation, but what I'm here, I'm thank you for having the conversation. I'm really glad that we had that. And there's a lot, even ideas amongst ourselves that we haven't really discussed through yet. And so, what other options are, what other service models? I think, how do we have this discussion? Is it through the advisory committee? Are four of us going to come to the North Albany committee meeting, whatever that is? Are we going to come? Are we going to participate in the committee advisory committee? And what do you want to do to the sort of board?
I think, just my take, it's something I think we would have to talk about, not in this room.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, people probably need some time to reflect about how much time they have to dedicate, how involved they can be. Because what we're talking about isn't, what we've been doing, which was as successful as it possibly could have been under the circumstances. This is much more intimate, deep, meaningful engagement with the community. Maybe we could light up the APL trustee's email address between us. I don't know.
It'd be better done in a bar.
It's almost
open up. Meeting.
No, that one.
Bar is a public space.
Yeah. All right, so there could be some conversation. Obviously, I wasn't asking for an answer. Like, let's think about that. All right, so this is something that's obviously really important. I'm glad you spent time on it because it's a very important decision for a city. And we need to figure out how we are going to be involved in that conversation or lead that conversation moving forward, because that really needs, to be board level. We are making the decision on what to do. The staff is supporting us with information and other services around that decision. But this is a board decision, we need to figure it out. So, to be continued, but let's not forever.
Can need to be continued, but with a next step, whether that be a committee meeting or some direction that. So, if we are going to get this advisory committee up and going, just so I'm clear, is that something that the committee is going to do, or is that something that we as the board are going to do? Because that would probably be, I'm hearing, possibly our next step. So how do we go about this?
It seemed to me that the committee would do it.
Okay.
But I'm not on the committee either.
I think the committee working along with Kelly Kimbrough.
So after this, maybe we can discuss dates to meet as a committee, mm-hmm. and we'll go from there, just keeping the rest of the board informed.
Okay, great. Thanks, everybody. Okay. Next item on the agenda is the quarterly evaluation of board meetings, and I did not notice that summary was not in the packet. So we can just table that till next time. Or I could read the...
No, table it, please.
Table.
Great. and then new business budget modifications. Mm-hmm.
met as the, finance committee, and basically what happens is, in the 5-year estimate, we have a new estimate for the current year. So we take that current year estimate, and then what we do is to make the current year estimate become the budget modification. So that will be, that current year estimate column is going to be our new budget column. And so then what we need to do is to find funding if we have a source of money, if revenue is coming in higher than the budget and if expenses are coming lower, those are sources of money that we can take money to these various categories. And the uses are when the revenue estimate is lower than the budget or expenses are higher. So basically, this chart that you have in front of you just shows what the new estimate is, what the budget was, and where the variance is, and how we fund it. So the first one, New York State Grants and Aid, is only coming in $1,457 higher, and we apply that to maintenance supplies. And so basically, we went through every line with the finance committee. I don't think it's necessary probably for me to go through every line with you. That's exactly the process of how we did it. And the bottom line is, since the board retreat, it looks like we'll probably use the bottom line of the estimate is that we'll use $49,000 of fund balance for this year. That means our revenue will be $49,000, our revenue less our expenses will be, we'll use $49,000. So that's how it all works. If you want to go through line by line, I can. But that's how it all comes, and the current estimate will become the new budget. So when the auditors give you the financial, they will put in the original budget and the estimate, both on the
So as someone that was at the finance committee meeting, I can say this was thoroughly vetted and examined. There were a lot of great questions. I have two questions for you right now.
Okay.
This is both a revenue and expenditure neutral in the overall sense set of documents, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. So we're just moving money around a little bit, and neither services nor employee, nothing is being diminished.
Correct.
At all. Okay.
But the bottom line for the board is that 2017 is coming in better than the budget. We think we're going to use $49,000. We had budgeted that we were going to use $340,000. When I went through the 5-year plan, I went through line by line what was better. But so that means that we're $291,000 better than our budget. And a lot of it has to do, you know, with some lower costs and, you know, obviously lower salaries, lower New York State retirement costs, slightly lower health insurance. All those, the current estimate for budget column on the 5-year plan gives you all the categories. So we went through all of those in detail at the board retreat. So this is just the action so that we move those categories and we show that we are funding them.
Given the rigorous examination by the Finance Committee and the larger board's previous experience with these budget modifications, I would like to make a motion that we adopt the budget amendments as presented.
Thank you.
Can
I have a second?
I second. Brenda seconds it.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right. Motion carries unanimously. And next is a public comment. And there's no public left. We'll get that. We're into the executive session, so it's time to adjourn. Oh, motion to adjourn.
I'll take a second.
I make that.